Good day, everyone, and thank you for having me share with you today. So I'm going to quickly share with you my perspective from the point of a pediatric surgeon about primary repair of unilateral cleft lip. What I'm going to try to do in the next few minutes is to highlight some of the anatomical abnormalities in unilateral cleft lip, some of the goals that we try to achieve in repair, the appropriate timing, and some of the preoperative or pre-surgical steps that we often take. I will try to highlight key operative and post-operative steps, but I'm not going to go into detailed operative description, given the very short time we have. So that will be a little bit outside our scope. I will highlight some of the outcomes and the common complications that we see and how we try to avoid some of them. And I will end by just saying a little bit about what I think the current advances and future directions probably will be. Regarding anatomy, we do see a wide range of anatomic configurations, but I think the key important aspects is that the cleft may affect only the lip, may not be complete, may be complete when the floor of the nose on that side is affected. The alveolus on that side may also be affected, and the palate on that side may be affected. And some of the clefts are actually quite wide. And I think for the very wide ones, I would say highlight what we do sometimes to improve on the outcome. In terms of the anatomy also, the distortions include obviously the orbicularis oris is disrupted and abnormally attached, and the pull of some of the fascial muscles on the abnormally attached orbicularis oris helps to keep the cleft open, and then the nose, the alar nasi, the nasal bridge are all distorted, and those are some of the things that we try to correct during the surgery. So to quickly highlight the issues with the lip, the abnormal attachment of the orbicularis oris to the edges of the cleft, the Cupid's bow is distorted. That's the Cupid's bow is one of the anatomical landmarks that make the lip look so nice. The vermilion and the border, vermilion border is also disrupted, and the philtrum obviously is disrupted. Alar nasi is also abnormally attached. The floor of the nose when it is involved is also disrupted. And the nasal bridge often is deviated to one side. Now, when the alveolus is affected, the implication is the fact that where the upper incisors are going to come out from may create problems. For some of the very wide clefts, there may be some degree of hypoplasia of the maxilla on the cleft side, and that makes the repair a little bit more problematic, and the growth of that side of the face may also be affected. In terms of some of the goals that we try to achieve, the important thing, I think the most important thing to restore is to restore continuity of the lip, and not just continuity anyhow, but we want to ensure that right from the skin through the muzzle to the level of the mucosa are all properly aligned. We want to restore the integrity of the nasal floor when the cleft is complete. Very importantly, we want to achieve symmetry of the lip and also of the nose, and we want to as much as possible either conceal the resulting scar from the repair or minimize the extent of scarification that happens. The lip is the face is very visible. So any scarification there may create cosmetic issues. In terms of timing, although we do say that ideally the repair should be done of the lip by the age of 10 to 12 weeks. However, we know that in our setting, we see children, many children presenting well beyond that age. But for those that we see from the neonatal period, the optimum timing really should be about 10 to 12 weeks. And not just about age, the child needs to be growing and developing well with adequate weight for age. And the weight we expect at about that 3 months should be about 4.5 to 5 kilograms, or about 10 pounds. And we want the child to have adequate hemoglobin level, so it should not be anemic, shouldn't have a hemogram of less than 10 grams per deciliter. So if all these issues are present, if anemia is present, weight is a problem, then it means it's not yet the right time to repair that lip. Some of the pre-surgical issues that we consider, sometimes some orthopedic care, orthodontic care may be required, especially for the very wide clefts, because if they are too wide, the tendency is that we will end up with some repair under tension, and that is likely to create a very wide and ugly looking scar. So for the children that have very wide clefts, and that usually happens if the palate on that side is also affected, we try to use some form of, most times some form of strapping alone may be all that is needed, starting from a few weeks of age until the time of repair. That will help to narrow the cleft to significantly so that we end up with a good repair. Adequate nutrition needs to be provided. And we used to think that nutrition is only a problem when the palate is involved, but we see many children that the reality is once there's a cleft lip, oftentimes some of the attention to feeding that the family needs to give is not there. So just simple cleft lip alone may be associated with some degree of malnutrition. So we may need to address the nutrition to ensure that the child is well nourished before the repair. Any infection needs to be controlled, especially if the palate is affected, and the child needs to be growing and developing well. And very importantly, we do know that up to 30 to 50% of clefts are associated with some degree of cardiac anomalies. So in my practice, we try as much as possible to exclude cardiac anomalies by doing echocardiography. Many years ago, when we were not routinely doing echocardiography in these babies, we've run into intraoperative problems with anesthesia. So we at the moment try to ensure that we exclude cardiac anomalies routinely. In terms of the surgery, I've said I'm not going to go into details of the specific surgical issues. However, I think that the available operative techniques for cleft lip repair are so many different types, different levels of complexity exist. But I think that the most important aspect is the fact that we need to be flexible in our choice of technique. As a pediatric surgeon, we try to keep it as simple as possible. So we try to avoid procedures that are a little bit too complex, that require raising complex flaps. And we also choose a procedure that we find easy to teach to our trainees. So for this reason, many of us will choose to use the Millard's repair for the natural cleft lip. We find it easy to teach. However, we must appreciate that several modifications may be necessary even at the time of surgery, depending on some of the operative findings. So if the cleft is too wide and we find that a routine Miller's repair is not going to work, we may need to modify that technique. However, I think that as cleft surgeons, we also need to be familiar with a few other techniques so that when we find that the technique we are very familiar with is not working, we should be flexible enough to change to another technique. But I think that the bottom line is to choose a technique that works for us, rather than choosing a technique that we think is more popular. So for us, we routinely will use the Miller's repair for most of them, and we modify as necessary. There are a few key operative considerations. Some are quite basic, but we keep trying to emphasize them because they do influence the outcome of repair. Use of appropriate instrumentations, fine instruments are is very important. We don't want to crush tissues. Some of the tissue at that age, 10 to 12 weeks that we are talking about, are very delicate. Using appropriate sutures, so I would routinely use either a Vicryl suture or a PDS suture of appropriate size for age, and I'll say a little bit more about that down the line. I would routinely use some magnification. I think magnification minimum of about 2.5 loop helps to make the tissues clearer and helps to make it possible to achieve adequate orientation and alignment of tissues. And it's good to pay very careful and attention to hemostasis, because the lip bleeds a lot. And when it starts bleeding, that's the time we begin to make mistakes and create the environment for complications to set in. So having said that, I think one of the first things we do is to identify our landmarks. One of the images earlier on clearly says what some of the anatomic landmarks on the lip are. Is to identify our landmarks, make our markings depending on whatever repair technique that we are choosing. The markings are so important because they help us to align the tissues properly, making sure that we don't suture the wrong tissues to themselves. Sometimes adequate measurements may be necessary because we don't want one side of the lip to become longer or higher than the other side of the lip. So measurements of those markings are crucial. One of the challenges in many of our settings is the fact that the skin markers, operating skin markers, are not routinely available. So many years ago, we tried to use all kinds of different ways, including using povidone iodine to do the marking. But presently, we now have proper surgical markers, so we're able to do our markings and measure them adequately. We also try to create a preemptive hemostasis by using some vasoconstrictor. Adrenaline is very popular with most of us. Some will use adrenaline alone, but I routinely will use adrenaline analgesia provided by lignocaine. But I think the key point here is to ensure that we use the appropriate dosage carefully calculated for age to avoid creating any cardiac problems. And whenever we are using adrenaline or lignocaine, I think that if halotane anesthesia is being used, then we need to let the anesthetist know beforehand that we are going to be using adrenaline and lignocaine, and they will know what to do, because some of the children run into problems with adrenaline and lignocaine if halotane anesthesia is being used. Having done our markings, the first part is really to detach the abnormal attachment of the orbicularis oris from the edges of the cleft and mobilize them away carefully from the edges of the cleft, and then follow our markings to create our flaps. When the alveolus is affected, I will routinely repair the alveolar soft tissue. Now, this helps sometimes. I found that if that the alveolar soft tissue is repaired at the time of the primary cleft lip repair, some of them may not need any alveolar bone graft down the line. However, some will leave the alveolus alone and then have the child have an alveolar bone graft later. Having raised flaps, again, the lip bleeds a lot, but most times, in addition to the adrenaline, pressure, digital pressure alone will control some of the bleeding. However, we use the Ameh to carefully raise some of the flaps, but we should as much as possible avoid extensive monopolar diatomic coagulation. If we have bipolar forceps available, that's very excellent in controlling any bleeding. It's important to note here that the muzzle needs to be completely and carefully separated from the overlying skin as well as from the underlying mucosa. Failure to do this is one of the factors that can result in tension and asymmetry of the lip and the nose. With proper separation, we will now be able to bring the muscles together properly without tension. So the bottom line, I think, of the repair is to ensure that we have a tension-free repair, and making sure that all anatomical layers are repaired to each other. So mucosa must go be repaired to mucosa, muscle to muscle, and skin to skin. At that age of 10 to 12 weeks, I most times will use a Vicry or PDS 5-0 for the mucosa, a 4-0 for the muscle, and a 4-0 for the skin. Now, this is where, while repairing and advancing some of the our flaps, this is where ensuring symmetry comes in. This is where all the measurements we have taken comes in. And we want to ensure that the labia height on the cleft and the non-cleft side are the same side. The either side of the Cupid's bow are the same length. We need to repair the nasal floor. And at this stage, we don't make any extensive effort to address severe nasal deformity. That really, I leave that for a later date for a secondary surgery to address that. However, for minor deformities, those can be corrected at the time of the primary cleft lip repair. In the post-operative period, adequate and for us, this is a crucial part. As pediatric surgeons, we find it very distressing to see a child in pains. So adequate analgesia, right from even before the child wakes up from anesthesia, we would always ask the anesthetist to give some intravenous paracetamol. Many times we will also put in a rectal non-steroidal agent, either diclofenac or ibuprofen. And most times this would suffice for analgesia. However, if we needed to do extensive mobilization for wide clefts, in addition to the paracetamol, we'll also add a parenteral non-steroidal agent, and what we use most of the time is ketorolac. These two agents are able to keep the child very comfortable. I don't routinely use antibiotics for cleft lip repair. We change dressings according to whether they are soaked with secretions. Many times, really, because of secretions from the nose, the dressing gets soaked easily. So we will change the dressing once we feel that they are dirty or looking soaked. In terms of what to do with the sutures, as a young, in my early days, I would routinely try to remove the sutures by day five. But the challenge in trying to remove the sutures is the fact that you need sedation, which has to be done in a safe way. And many times in our setting, the only way you can do that is getting back into the operating room, and getting operating space was always a problem. So if you need to remove sutures, that should be done under adequate and safe sedation. Because we are routinely using absorbable sutures, they can be left alone. However, when they are left alone, it's important that we know that they take several weeks for them to get absorbed or to fall off, which means that we need to ensure that the parents are able to keep the place clean. Because one of the things that happens, especially if the sutures are Vicry sutures, is that secretions from the nose begin to stick to them, and that may become a focus for infection. Right, so some of the common complications that many of us encounter are notching of the vermilion border, the vermilion and the vermilion border. This usually happens if we haven't, if we've not adequately aligned the tissues and the margins, the vermilion border, and also if there's some small amount of tension at the level of the vermilion border, that would tend to create some notching. Sometimes there may be asymmetry. Now, if you look at this image, you notice that on one side, on the cleft side, the muscle is bunched up, and what has happened there is that the full extent, the complete extent of the muscles were not aligned and sutured to each other. So on the cleft side, the muscle has bunched up there, and because that has happened, even the vermilion border was not properly aligned. And you can see that the Cupid bow there is asymmetric. There is also a notch there. And because the muscles were not properly aligned, you can see that the vermilion border is asymmetric. The non-cleft side looks fuller than the cleft side. So this is one of the factors that leads to asymmetry if the tissues are not brought together properly. We've encountered wound complications, either partial dehiscence or complete dehiscence. This doesn't occur often. The few times we've had it were when we tried to take out the sutures by fifth day, and sedation and analgesia was not adequate. So those resulted in some of the dehiscence. However, if we use inappropriate size of sutures, then there's a risk that we may get a complete dehiscence. Oronasal fistula may happen in those who have a complete cleft, especially if they have velos or the palate is affected. And if the nasal floor was not completely and adequately repaired. So that may happen. Scar complications, again, if the repair is under tension, the scar may become very wide. A few children may develop hypertrophic scar, which may require revision at a later date. So these are some of the common complications that we have faced. And now, if everything goes well, some secondary surgeries may be required. If some complication happened, if there was a notch, if there was asymmetry, some lip revision may be required down the line. For those that have involvement of the alveolus, some alveolar bone graft may be required down the line. And nasal deformity, especially if severe, may need to be corrected down the line. Yeah, but those aspects are outside the scope of our talk for today. Some of the advances that are happening is a fact that as pediatric surgeons, there have been a lot of advances regarding what we can do even before the baby is born. And for cleft, although most prenatal interventions that are done at the moment are targeted at congenital anomalies that have that are very life-threatening. Clefts are not life-threatening, however, because of the cosmetic nature. Experimentally, people have tried to repair them in utero, mostly by fetal endoscopy. And the possible advantages are the fact that the fetus doesn't form scars. So if we are able to repair it before the baby is born, then it means that there's not going to be any scar. For those that have very wide clefts, repairing in utero may enhance facial development. And then some of the secondary problems that we face following cleft lip repair may be eliminated. However, this is still mostly experimental. Several questions still exist. We really still don't know in the full extent of the effects of craniofacial, what effects prenatal repair will have on craniofacial growth and development. We still are not very sure that we can reliably make a diagnosis of clefts by ultrasound alone, because that's the least invasive way of making a prenatal diagnosis. And if we're able to exclude other more severe congenital anomalies, because these are all things that need to be done to bring this into clinical use. Some of the technical challenges that may be faced is also still not very well known. And further studies really need to be done in animals to see what improvements doing a prenatal repair can have. But I bring this up because I think that we are probably going to get to a point that we may not need to be doing terribly too many, especially for the very severe ones, too many severe cleft repairs postnatally. Hopefully, we should get there someday. So thank you very much. So that's the end of my talk. Thank you. So back to the moderator.
Thank you so much, Professor Ameh, for very enlightening presentation. We have quite a number of questions here, but before I go to the questions, I will implore the house to keep your questions in the chat box. We'll take them as we go. So I'll just start with the few we have on ground. We have about 8 of them. The first one said, please, is there a specific impact of width of the cleft on the aesthetic outcome? I believe you mentioned that, but maybe we'll just, to clarify, yeah. Maybe we'll just take that.
Right, so certainly there's an impact. Like I said, if the cleft is too wide, chances are that our repair will be under tension and the scar is going to be wide. It's also going to be difficult to do all the alignments that we are talking about to do them properly. So the notching we are talking about may happen more. Asymmetry of both the lip and the nose may also happen more often. So that is why when the cleft is too wide, we try to use some form of strapping to narrow the defect significantly before surgery.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Then the next question is, the next attendee wants to know if you combine anterior palate closure with lip repair.
Right. So I did say that we will only do that if just the alveolus is involved. We will repair the alveolar soft tissues at the time of lip repair. But we will, if it's a whole palate that is involved, we really don't do any anterior palate repair. We will only repair alveolar soft tissue. We leave any other thing to a later date.
And somebody wants to know what your preferred strength of dilution for adrenaline and xylokine is to achieve hemostasis.
Right. So I think for us, the most important aspect is the dosage. So with adrenaline, we will use 7 milligrams per kilogram. So once we get the total, most of the time it comes at 2%. And once we get the total calculation of 7 milligrams per kilogram, we then dilute it and bring it down to 0.5%. So that will be the strength that we will use.
And somebody wants to know how should the depth of the dissection of the muscle layer from skin and the mucosa, okay? I'm assuming they mean that do you separate? I'm not sure, but I think the person is meaning that do you separate the skin from the mucosa before you put them together? But he was asking about the depth. I'm not very clear about that question.
Yes, I did mention that to be able to do a tension-free repair, you need to separate the muscle completely from the overlying skin. And when I say completely, so we free it from the skin for a distance of about 0.5 centimeters from the edge, and we do the same thing on the mucosa side. So the muscle is completely free and we can bring them together across the cleft.
Okay, thank you, sir. Then another question is, during the dissection of orbicularis muscle, should we be in the subperiosteum? Should we go as far as the subperiosteum layer?
No, I stay just immediately above the periosteum, just enough to detach it from the periosteum, because going under the periosteum now risks damaging the maxilla at that age is so delicate, and we don't want to do anything that will interfere with the growth and development of the maxilla. So I stay just above the periosteum. I don't go under the periosteum.
Then another question. Someone wants to know what your favorite technique for the repair of microform cleft is.
Like I routinely we use Millard repair routinely and modify it according to whatever challenges we face intraoperatively. All the other types of repairs, my consideration is that some of the flaps are a little bit slightly too complex, especially to teach to residents. So I keep it as simple as possible. And I think that the Miller's repair is simpler, is very simple. It can be modified to suit whatever technical challenges are faced intraoperatively.
Another question wants to know if there's a line, is it a time frame for the revision of surgery, or in the revision done as soon as complication, or do you do the complications as soon as you notice them?
The only complication I will fix immediately is if there's a complete dehiscence. So that needs to be repaired immediately if the dehiscence was not due to an infection. Obviously, if it was due to an infection, I will control the infection and then repair, allow everything to heal and come back after 6 months to repair. If there's a complication, I will wait for 6 months. I used to wait 6 weeks, but then I realized that 6 weeks was probably a bit too early. So once there's a complication requiring revision, I will wait for 6 months.
Then another person wants to know if you allow the child to start breastfeeding immediately.
Not directly from the breast. So we will use express breast milk until we take out the sutures. That's by day five.
Okay. But just in case there are any pediatricians or nutritionists listening, would that be from a bottle or by cup or spoon?
No, it's by cup or spoon. I've not seen a feeding bottle for a long time. So. Yeah.
Okay. And then somebody said that you mentioned intrauterine repair. Is this wishful thinking or a feasible procedure in our setting? If not, what is the prospect of this in the near future?
I like being aspirational, realistically aspirational. So even in the well-developed high-income countries, it's still at experimental stage. But I think that it's very appealing, and the possibility of having a scarless repair and having the facial bones growing properly make it very appealing. At the moment, it's certainly not something that is feasible in our setting, even the experimental level, because there are several maternal and fetal considerations that go along with it. So at the moment, that is why I emphasize that they are still experimental, and there are things that the younger people can begin to aspire and think about. I think in the coming decades, at some point, we'll probably get there.
Okay. Then somebody wants to know if there's still a place for straight line repair.
I don't think so. All the straight line repairs I saw as a trainee ended up with significant asymmetry or notch. Even those clefts that appear relatively incomplete and looked as if a straight line repair would work. So I don't favor straight line repair at all. But I'm sure some other people may think differently.
Okay. Then one more question. Somebody wants to know if you do tip rhinoplasty or other form of rhinoplasty at the time of primary repair, if there's significant nose deformity.
No, I don't. I leave all significant nasal reconstruction to a later date.
Yeah, and one last question just came in and I was just waiting for it. Somebody wants to know that what's your comment about lip adhesion in the cases of very wide cleft? I was just waiting for that.
I've never used it. So I would rather find strapping to be easy. Mothers can do it and apply it easily, and it has worked for me. I've never used lip adhesions. I've only tried to do that once in a wide bilateral cleft, but I wasn't quite happy with it. So I will favor strapping all the time than lip adhesions. But I'm sure, again, some people may think differently. It may work better for some other people.
Okay. Oh, thank you so much, Prof. It's been a really enlightening presentation. Once again, thank you, Smile Train. Thank you, West African College of Surgeons, for bringing this together. And to you, the attendees, thank you very much for being such wonderful attendees. This series of lectures continue all the way into July. We hold them Mondays and Tuesdays at 11 a.m. So we implore all to please be on time so we can start and finish on time. Thank you so much, everybody. Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you, everyone. Bye.